you enjoyed a little bit of Chris Isaak there. And like I've, you may have heard me say before, sometimes I like to start these out with a little bit of music. Mostly it's for me. If you don't like the music, you're always welcome to fast forward. This is the third lecture video in Unit 1. In the last lecture, we talked about safety engineering. Started laying the groundwork for the idea of safety engineering, which leads us to a discussion of the hierarchy of controls. Some of you have seen this before, some of you maybe not. Let me talk about what we mean by hierarchy of controls. First of all, we need to talk about what is a control strategy. Now that wasn't very good, I just knocked my water off. And now I knock a can off. I'm just batting 1,000 here. What do we mean by control strategy? For our purposes, a control strategy is a very broad method or philosophy for controlling hazards in the workplace. There are several different control strategies that we can talk about. When we rank these strategies from most effective to least effective, we end up with the hierarchy of controls. OSHA has a hierarchy of controls. This is their hierarchy of controls, starting with engineering controls at the top, meaning it is assumed to be most effective at controlling the hazards, followed by administrative controls. Then at the very bottom of their hierarchy, least effective and least desirable would be personal protective equipment. But OSHA is not the only agency or organization that publishes a hierarchy of controls. NIOSH, ISO 45001, ANSI Z10, they have a slightly different hierarchy of controls. They start with elimination as being the most effective, followed by substitution, engineering, and then administrative and personal protective equipment. Then we have a hierarchy of controls that is mentioned in chapter 1 of your text. I know I haven't assigned chapter 1 yet. You won't read chapter 1 until we get to the third unit. But when we get to the third unit, you'll read chapter 1, and the textbook author talks about pretty much the same thing as the NIOSH, ISO, ANSI hierarchy of controls, but they add warning systems to their hierarchy, or safety devices and warning systems. Notice they don't have engineering. Instead of engineering, they have safety devices and warning systems. What we want to focus on for the sake of simplicity, and really it's the most applicable for most of us as safety managers, we want to focus on the OSHA hierarchy of controls, the three levels of control that OSHA publishes and talks about, and you'll see in a lot of their documentation. When you take certification exams, you would be expected to know about the NIOSH, ISO, ANSI. I don't think you'll probably ever encounter in a test or anywhere else the hierarchy of controls that we see in Chapter 1 of the textbook. The first two, you might see. The first one is, for me, the hierarchy of controls that should guide our work as a safety manager. As a safety manager, as a safety professional, our goal is to control hazards at the highest level of effectiveness. Whenever possible, we want to control hazards at the engineering level. And you'll notice I've highlighted some of these different levels in green across these three different approaches, or these three different hierarchies. The NIOSH, ISO, ANSI hierarchy for elimination, substitution, and engineering, what's really happening is that OSHA is combining those under the engineering control, under their idea of an engineering control. The hierarchy in Chapter 1, Elimination, Substitution, Safety Devices, these can be combined under engineering. And the author seems to imply that warning systems should also be, considered an engineering control. But, and I'll talk about this more, we got a separate slide on warning systems. Most warning systems to me are administrative controls, and we'll talk more about that as we talk about what the different controls really are all about. Let's first talk in more detail about the engineering control level. And we've already hinted at this with our discussion of safety engineering in the previous video. This is the highest level of control. It's most effective. It may completely eliminate the hazard. If it doesn't completely eliminate the hazard, it may completely control the hazard. Or if it's not quite as effective, it can still be an engineering control, but it only partially controls the hazard. The best engineering controls require no action from the worker. The worker can go about their business without doing anything, and they will be protected by the best engineering controls. They don't have to flip a switch. They don't have to respond to flashing lights. They don't have to turn something off. They don't have to use lockout, tagout to protect themselves from hazardous energy sources. The engineering or the system itself is designed so that there is virtually no way they can be injured by that system. The best engineering control, and I've said this before, when we talked about safety engineering, the best engineering control will protect the most careless worker. Now, this level of engineering control is, again, the very best. There are, honestly, I would say there are very few control systems that will perfectly protect without a chance of failure, without the chance that a worker could be injured or that something could go wrong and cause property damage or some other loss incident. But this is what we're shooting for as safety managers. We want to control at the highest level. That's our goal. That's our objective. That's what we're shooting for. We're not always going to be able to achieve this. There are some hazards out there that we can engineer out of the workplace. We have to resort to other control strategies, administrative controls, even personal protective equipment may be the best control for some of those hazards that we encounter occasionally in the workplace. So this is what we're talking about when we talk about engineering controls in general. Now let's break it down in a little more detail with a little more specificity. Let's talk about engineering using an elimination approach. With elimination, we're finding a safer method for performing a task, thereby eliminating the hazard. And there are other examples of elimination also, but this is one of the more common types of scenarios we're going to encounter. We change the work method or the work process, thereby eliminating the hazard. An example would be controlling the hazard of fall protection. We can eliminate fall hazards by taking whatever we were doing up in the air where there's a potential for a fall and bringing that down to the ground level. Where you're on the ground level, there's no way someone can fall. They can have a fall incident on the same level, which does happen and does cause a lot of injuries, but they're not going to have a fall from elevation when we bring all the work down to a ground level. A good example of this is from the bridge construction industry. There are two ways to make girder connections. You can hang the girders up in the air and then bolt them together. Talking about steel girders that require splice plates and bolts. You hang the girders up in the air, you put your splice plates on, you drive in your drift pins, and then you start bolting it all together. You can do that up in the air. Or the better way of doing that, so you don't have workers exposed to significant fall hazards, you bolt everything together on the ground. If you have two girders that need to be bolted together, you do it on the ground. Once they're bolted together, you lift them up and hang them onto the top of the substructure of the bridge. A simple example, and a lot of these controls are just require some thinking. How can we do this safer? Is there a safer way? Critical thinking comes into play. How can we eliminate the hazard of falling? Another example, and again, I'm taking it from the construction industry. That's my wheelhouse. There are workers every year killed when trenches cave in. A lot of these trench cave-ins occur during the process of utility installation. They're putting in water lines or sewer lines or telecommunication lines. They dig this trench, they put workers down into the trench to make the connections or do whatever they need to do. And if that trench has not been sloped or shored properly, it could cave in and cause fatalities. Speaking of trench cave-in fatalities, I think this year in 2022, and if this isn't 2022 down the road, just in 2022, in August of 2022, we are up to about 45 trench-related fatalities in the United States, trench cave-in-related fatalities. But one way of eliminating this type of incident is to not put guys in the trench at all. One of the ways that you can avoid putting workers in the trench at all is with certain equipment. You can use horizontal boring equipment and pull the conduit through the bore that's being created. And I've got a video coming up. I'll just give you a quick glimpse of this technology. Another way of eliminating this, and this is more the way we do work here, it's called cut and cover, where you have machinery that creates a furrow, and as that furrow is created, it lays the conduit, the pipe, or whatever it is that we're laying in this trench, it lays it in place without workers having to get inside of a trench. But let me give you an example of the horizontal boring approach. And I've got most of the video, I think, in the record window.
We're digging up the area so we can spot all the utilities, and when we put our pipe...
Okay, that's a horizontal drilling machine. They can drill underneath buildings, they can drill underneath streets, and they can pull or push the conduit through the borehole that they're creating. No one has to get inside of a trench for a lot of utility work. And a lot of utility work can use this kind of technology. It doesn't have to be an open trench.
We're at depth, and we can see all the utilities, so we do not cut them. And then once we pull our pipe back, we'll have a ditch already dug. We just lay the pipe in there.
And this will usually, they saw a little bore pit there. Sometimes it'll start with a bore pit to get the operation going. That was a little bore pit. Some projects, you might have a bore pit that's 20 feet deep. And in those 20-foot deep bore pits, workers may have to get inside of that. But when workers are inside there, you would have a shoring system in place to protect them while they're inside that bore pit. But the idea of a bore pit, you have this bore pit to get the operation started, and once the bore pit is in place, then you can go underneath a building or underneath a roadway or whatever it is you need to go underneath. The job I was on where we had the 20-foot deep bore pit was University of Oklahoma campus. We had to put a storm sewer underneath one of the libraries on OU's campus. OU has multiple libraries, and this storm drain system was going underneath the library. Couldn't just tear up the library. You had to bore underneath it and push your pipe through. And this was a big structure we're talking about. I believe the conduit was 36-inch concrete pipe that was going underneath the library. We had a bore pit where it started and a bore pit where it came out. But there were workers exposed, but not as many workers were as exposed as there would have been if it had been a complete open trench excavation and laying of the storm drain conduit.
Into the transformer. They used to just dig a long trench from point A to point B, and there would be like a lot of dirt, a lot of cleanup that they would have to do. Instead of digging like straight across, it's just one small patch instead of one long ditch across the road. Then in the yards, like a little bit of seed and straw, and it just in one section instead of like a whole long.
Yep, you get the idea. Let me go ahead and stop the video there. And now, one thing, and if I'd continued, he explains the productivity advantages of this technology. And there are productivity advantages of horizontal boring and other similar methods. But for us as safety managers, we're interested in primarily the safety advantages, how it makes it safer for the workers. And a lot of times we see this time and time again, the safer way is the more efficient, the more productive way. And that's an argument we can make to our bosses in the future when we have a proposal for a new work procedure that we think will be more safe. Don't just talk about the safety side of it, talk about the how it might affect productivity and increase the efficiency of the operation. All right, we've talked about engineering elimination. Now let's talk about substitution and some examples. This would also be a engineering control, but we're substituting one thing for another. An example would be replacing a petroleum-based form release oil with a vegetable-based oil that controls the chemical hazard. It controls or eliminates workers' exposure to harsh chemicals. It also helps protect the environment. In some areas of the country, it may be required to use a vegetable-based oil for your form release substance. And I should say what I mean by form release oil. Concrete work, you have your forms that hold the wet concrete. Well, before you put the concrete in those forms, the forms are sprayed with an oily substance that will improve the quality of the finished concrete, also make it easier to pull the forms away from the concrete. That's just every concrete job where forms are used will have some type of form and some type of form release oil. And it's very common, the most common agent used is a vegetable-based substance. Now, back in the 90s, early 2000s even, it was very common to go onto a construction site and they were spraying diesel fuel on their concrete forms. Diesel fuel works really great, and a lot of the old timers they still swear by diesel fuel. They hate vegetable-based form release oil because, you know, they just think diesel fuel is so much better. But the vegetable-based stuff works just fine, protects the environment, protects workers. We're substituting a good thing for a bad thing, or a less harmful thing for a more harmful thing. And that's the idea of an engineering substitution type of control. Another example has to do with sandblasting. Sandblasting, we think of using sand and the blasting machine to remove paint or to remove rust from a metal surface or whatever surface it might be. Well, when you have sand, you have a silica hazard. That silica hazard can be controlled by using something other than sand. You can use crushed walnut shells, for example. And there are other blasting media possibilities as well. Again, using other blasting media is not just for safety, it also has to do with quality and productivity. If we use normal sandblasting sand on some objects, we might destroy that object. But if we use walnut shells instead of sand, then it's not going to destroy the object. It's going to remove whatever it is we're trying to remove without destroying the object. Now keep in mind, some of the other media that might be used in place of sand may also have some exposure hazards associated with it. Walnut shells, for example, there may be some workers that would be affected by breathing in the dust from the walnut shells. Now, there are poisonous woods and poisonous wood-based substances out there. Now, that would be something to explore in your operation. What possible exposures are created by using this alternative substance? We may control silica, but we may have other exposures. Another example of substitution, let's say if we have some indoor work to do and we want to use a piece of heavy equipment. We have to take an excavator inside of a large building to dig a trench. Well, you could take a gasoline, diesel-powered excavator inside of that building, but then you're creating a carbon monoxide hazard. The alternative would be an electric-powered excavator, and they do exist. With an electric-powered excavator, you're not going to have the carbon monoxide hazard. We ran into this on a job in Denver. The police vehicle service station that was being constructed that we were a part of, one of our subcontractors needed to do some excavation inside this building. What we were doing was renovating an old building, repurposing an old building into a facility where the police cars could be serviced and worked on and so on. But they brought this excavator into this old building, and it was a diesel-powered excavator. It was a mini excavator. It's perfect for that application, but it produced carbon monoxide. We had to stop what they were doing, persuade them that carbon monoxide was not a good thing to be breathing, and that they needed to bring in an electric-powered excavator or come up with another way of performing that excavation. I mean, we even talked about hand digging it as a possibility, because carbon monoxide is a significant hazard that's created by internal combustion engines. Yeah, just a few examples of engineering by substitution. Then we have engineering based upon engineering controls that are all based on how the system is designed, or how a tool is designed, the technology that's utilized. When we talk about engineering controls with design or technology, we're talking about methods or systems built into the design of a plant, equipment, or process to minimize the hazard. We're separating the worker from the hazard. We're preventing. If not preventing, we're reducing the potential for harm that can occur as a result of that hazard. And we're going to talk about a lot more of these when we get into Unit 2 and Unit 3. I'm going to throw out some examples here, but we'll talk about a lot more examples of how we can design systems that may not be perfectly slam dunk safe, but they can greatly reduce the probability that an incident will occur because of the way they're designed. Again, once these are built into the system, the worker ideally does not need to do anything. One example, and we're going to talk more about what we call safeguarding or machine guarding as the semester goes along, but machine safety using a presence sensing pad is an example of a component that is used to make machines more safe. Let me just read this to you. A presence sensing pad, the pad is located in a danger area. When a worker steps on the pad, the machine shuts down. And I've got a diagram on the next slide that illustrates this even better. Another option would be locating the pad in a safe area away from the machine, and the machine will only function when the worker is on the pad. The operator has to be on the pad before the machine will function. But there is a potential problem with this setup. And I want you to think about what this potential problem is. Just take a second. What do you think might be a problem with this configuration? The machine will only function when the worker is standing in the safe area on the pad, versus the machine shuts down when the worker enters a danger area. Yep. Think about it. Let's go ahead and look at this diagram. This is a famous diagram you see all over the internet, but it illustrates what we're talking about. We have pressure mats or safety mats set up here. When these workers step on those mats, this industrial robot shuts down. This diagram also utilizes or shows a setup utilizing light curtains and other sensing devices, presence sensing devices. These presence sensing devices, they sense the presence of a worker in the danger area and shut down that machine immediately. But here's the deal with pressure mats. And here's the first option. When pressure is applied, machine shuts down. The second option, mat is in a safe area and machine will not function unless operator's on the mat. Here's the problem with that, potentially. The machine will function when the operator is on the mat, but it does not prevent another worker from entering the danger zone. A lot of times what we'll see with industrial machinery are multiple devices, multiple interlocks, multiple control devices. I'm going to talk about interlocks here in a subsequent slide. But you have multiple devices that would control for every conceivable failure that could occur within the system. And that's what we're really talking about. I haven't talked about failures of a system yet. That's going to come up in the next unit. But that's what we're talking about with a lot of incidents in the workplace. You think of a workplace as a system. A failure in that system of some sort can result in an incident that causes harm. It can cause a loss incident. Another example of an engineering control with technology would be a fire suppression system, an automated fire suppression system. In this example, I'm talking specifically about inert gas fire suppression systems. Fires need oxygen. You take away their oxygen, they die. It's really kind of amazing, the videos that are out there where they take away the oxygen source, the fire just goes away. Fires have to have oxygen. A fire is an oxidation reduction reaction, and you have to have oxygen for it to occur. If the oxygen is displaced in some way, the fire will die. With these inert gas fire suppression systems, there are sensors in place that detect a fire condition. Could be a flame detector, a heat sensor, a smoke sensor. We won't get into all the differences between those sensors there. Some sensors are better than others for this type of system. But there's some type of sensor that detects the fire. When the sensor detects the fire, the area is filled with an inert gas. Nitrogen, carbon dioxide is pumped into the area. That gas entering the area will displace the oxygen and put the fire out. Now, this doesn't prevent the fire, but this will effectively extinguish or suppress the fire when the fire is detected. You'll see this type of system used in a lot of facilities where they can't use water, they can't use foam, they can't use other extinguishing agents. Maybe it's a library, maybe it's a museum with artifacts that are thousands of years old, and if they sprayed water on the artifacts, it would destroy the artifact. Maybe it's a computer center, maybe it's a data center like we have up at Google and Pryor. You can't start spraying water or a lot of different extinguishing agents on a bunch of servers. That will cause a lot of problems. But inert gas can displace the oxygen, extinguish the fire, suppress the fire without significant damage to the objects or the systems within that structure. Now, it doesn't mean there's never going to be any damage. There may be damage involved, but it's going to be a lower degree of damage than you would have if you were using many other extinguishing agents. This is a very simple diagram illustrating what an inert gas system might look like. These are all the cylinders that you might see outside of a building that has an inert gas system. All these cylinders are going to be filled with the inert gas extinguishing agent. And here is a more of a diagram schematic showing the internal plumbing or the piping that delivers the inert gas to the areas that are protected by the inert gas system. This is a real simple engineering by design control. Simple guards and barricades, a physical barrier between the worker and the hazard, or between the danger and the property. Over on the left, and we're going to talk a lot more about machine guarding later in the semester, but over on the left we have a drive system with moving parts that would injure a worker if they got their hand inside of that system. But they are protected by the guard. And you're thinking, well, all they have to do is remove the guard and they can get hurt. Well, the best designs have what we call an interlocked guard. An interlocked guard, when it's removed, it shuts down power to the system. And we'll talk, again, we're going to talk a lot more about these, but an interlocked guard of a drive transmission system like this can protect workers from those moving parts. Now, over on the right is much, much simpler engineering control. This engineering control became a lot more common in public areas after the Oklahoma City bombing that occurred in April of 1995. These are bollards. Big steel or concrete and steel pipes, basically, that keep vehicles away from buildings. Or they keep a vehicle from running into a building. Yeah. I think it's probably safe to say that most federal buildings in the United States now have this type of protection in place. And you'll see retractable bollards, bollards that can be retracted so vehicles can drive through, and when vehicles aren't, when they don't need to move vehicles through there, they'll have the bollards up in position to keep other vehicles out. Again, these are going to be designed to keep a heavy truck full of explosives from driving into a building. But you also see this on a lesser scale around convenience stores, around other retail establishments. One of the common incidents that occur at convenience stores and different retail establishments is a vehicle driving through the front of the store. Bollards can help prevent vehicles from driving into a store. I wish we had time. We'll talk more about this later, but Quick Trip in Tulsa had a recent incident that was well publicized and cost Quick Trip a lot of money. It's an incident that could have been prevented with some type of guard or barricade system, bollards. A lot of Quick Trip stores have the equivalent of a bollard system, but other Quick Trip stores has not been retrofitted yet, and there's still the potential for serious incidents to occur. Even life-threatening incidents, not just to workers, but to customers of Quick Trip or whatever the business might be. I mentioned interlock systems. We'll talk more about this when we talk about machine safeguarding. An interlock system is normally we're talking about an electrical system that prevents a machine from operating in a potentially unsafe condition. It's usually some type of electronic switch system. An example would be a seat-activated kill switch on a riding mower, on a tractor, on a piece of heavy equipment. These seat-activated kill switches are designed so that there has to be a weight in the seat to form the electrical circuit that allows the machine to operate. You're gonna see a little bit of this when you read the roller failsafe article. There's going to be some examples of interlock systems in there, and I'm not going to use those examples. I want you to read about those. But a seat activated kill switch is a very common, relatively simple interlock system that protects workers and protects the public from different types of equipment. Present sensing mats, that's what I showed you before, was an interlock system. Light curtains around dangerous machinery would be another example. And we have examples of interlocks around our house. Now think about it for a second. What are some devices around our house that will not operate unless the door is closed? If you have devices in your house that won't operate unless the door's closed, that's an interlock system. And it's a system intended to make the device more safe. All right, we've talked about engineering controls, and again, a lot more. The class is about engineering controls, really, for the most part. But we need to talk about administrative controls, because engineering controls are not always possible. That's what we shoot for. That's our goal. That's our objective. Completely eliminate or control to the greatest degree possible the hazards in our workplaces. But sometimes engineering is not an option. We have to go to an administrative control. With administrative controls, they can take different forms, but we're using maybe rules or safe operating procedures or maybe certain devices, not devices that completely control the hazard but make it more safe in some way, but rules, procedures, devices, work practices to control hazards. Speaking of work practices, administrative controls are also referred to as work practice controls. But I like to think of a work practice control as a specific type of administrative control. And this is turning into a long lecture, and I apologize for that. But let's go ahead and knock this out. This is going to be the last one in this unit. The thing about administrative controls that makes them less effective is that their effectiveness is dependent on personnel following the rules and procedures. Or if it's a warning system, if it's a warning device, they have to respond to the warnings. An example of an administrative control when it comes to fall protection. Now, this is an OSHA allowed control in construction for some work environments to protect workers from falls. You can put a warning line 6 feet back from the edge. There are some other requirements as well, but the main thing is that it's 6 feet back from the edge. The idea for this warning line is that it keeps workers from getting too close to the edge. But workers can ignore the warning line. They can step over it. They can crawl under it. It doesn't protect them. It doesn't completely protect them from the fall hazard. They have to do something. They have to respond to that warning line in the right way. They have to make a decision. Another example of administrative controls, and we'll use rollers and compactors as an example here. There are incidents where workers are ran over by rollers. There was one July of 2021 in Texas, where a worker was ran over by a roller. And you think, how in the world does that happen? It can happen. Now, a company maybe they read about that incident in Texas that I'm referring to, and they came up with a policy that no workers within 20 feet of the roller. That's a good rule. But its effectiveness is only as good as the workers' willingness to follow that rule. Workers have to follow the rule. If they become complacent, if they think the rule doesn't apply to them, well, they can encroach within that 20-foot safe zone around the roller. Now, there are some engineering controls that, those are discussed in the roller article. There are some engineering controls that will help protect workers on the ground from moving equipment, moving vehicles. You can use work rotation. Let's say the hazard that we're dealing with is silica exposure. Workers are exposed to silica in their workplace. Measures are taken to limit the level of exposure, but there's still potential for exposure at a dangerous level, at the threshold limit value or greater. Well, one way to minimize that exposure and to help ensure that workers are not exceeding that threshold limit value for exposure is limit the amount of time they're exposed to the hazard. Now, let's say you have an 8-hour day. Instead of having a worker exposed to the hazard all 8 hours during that day, you have one worker doing that job in the morning. He or she is exposed for 4 hours, but in the afternoon he's doing something else. You have another worker that has the 4 hours of exposure, thereby eliminating their exposure, keeping it within what we would consider, what is generally considered a safe range, below the TLV value. And there are a lot of other examples where work rotation can be implemented, or job rotation can be implemented. You know, it could be heat exposure. You have workers exposed to a hot environment in the workplace. Well, don't have one worker exposed to the heat continually for an 8 or 10 hour shift, rotate workers in and out. Give workers a chance during the day periodically to perform a job away from that hot work environment. Many more examples. Now, one problem I've run into with this, and with silica in specifically, management sometimes often is going to be reluctant to approve job rotation. You know, there's some upper management out there, well, we hired them to do this job, they need to do this job. And they don't want to hire, sometimes work rotation requires hiring more people. They don't want to hire more people. They've got enough people. So that's one of the challenges we face periodically as a safety manager is convincing management. But I keep talking a lot about silica. There are a lot of good engineering controls for silica, though, which, again, we're not getting into that in this class. Industrial hygiene, I talk a lot about silica and silica controls. There are a lot of engineering systems out there that do an excellent job of protecting workers from silica dust in the workplace. Warning systems for me mostly are administrative controls. Depending on how it's set up, how it's designed, and the different components, it may take on more of an engineering feel, but most of the time, warning systems are administrative controls that alert workers to potentially hazardous conditions. They're alerted to the hazardous condition, then they must take action to avoid the hazard or to interrupt the dangerous process. An example would be a backup alarm on a vehicle. Backup alarms, beep, 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 beep. Get out of the way. That's what that backup alarm is saying, is get out of the way. Well, what if a worker's not paying attention? What if a worker is ignoring the backup alarm? They don't get out of the way. Horrible accident in, want to say, 2007, 2008 on a construction project in Tulsa. It was a truck that was backing up on a construction site. A worker was down on their knees doing something. The backup alarm was working. The worker was down on their knees. They were so engrossed in what they were doing that they didn't recognize that the truck was coming toward them, and they were backed over and crushed by that truck. I can give you more examples as well of similar instances where a backup alarm was ignored and serious loss incidents occurred because of that. And there's other technology that can be used, engineering types of technology. And let me go ahead and mention one example of that. There are presence sensing devices that can be mounted on equipment. This presence sensing device that's mounted on different pieces of equipment will sense the presence of people or other pieces of equipment in the area. It's like radar around the machine. When that radar detects something in the area, it shuts the machine down. It won't go forward, backward, sideways, or anyways, until whatever is in that area leaves or is removed from that area. We started using these systems on our skid steers when I was with Kiewit, because we were having a lot of metal-on-metal incidents with skid steers. Once we put the presence sensing devices on the skid steers, and it wasn't very expensive at all. I think it was $200 or $300 per machine to put these devices on. But once we put those devices on, our metal-on-metal incidents with skid steers pretty much disappeared. It doesn't completely eliminate the potential, but it greatly reduces that potential. Another example would be a carbon monoxide detector or a smoke alarm inside of a house. Smoke alarm goes off, that doesn't force people to leave. People can ignore the smoke alarm or the carbon monoxide detector. How many times have you been in a building and the fire alarm's going off? Nobody's doing anything. We have that all the time at NSU on the Tahlequah campus. There will be something will trip the alarm system and the alarm will go off, but people have become accustomed to knowing that it's probably just a false alarm. No need to panic, no need to leave. That's a dangerous environment right there when people ignore the alarms, especially in large public buildings like you have on university campuses. But another example of a warning system that's ignored is not effective. Now, there are some systems, and I'm skipping the no smoking sign. Maybe I shouldn't. Let me talk about the no smoking sign, and I've got a story to go along with that. You put a no smoking sign in a fueling area, at a convenience store or on an industrial site. A lot of industrial operations, they'll have diesel tanks or gasoline tanks for refueling equipment, forklifts or other equipment. And there will be no smoking signs all over the place. There will be no smoking signs. There will be fire extinguishers. All the cool stuff that looks good. But that no smoking sign doesn't prevent somebody from walking up to the tanks, leaning up on the tank and lighting up a cigarette. I've got a picture of a worker doing that from many years ago, and we had a real good laugh over it. He didn't realize what he was doing. He just wasn't even thinking. Yeah, another problem with warning systems and signs. Now, we need signs in our workplace. OSHA loves signs. Signs are not bad, but signs are not your foolproof safety measure that some folks may think they are. Now, there are warning systems out there that are more complex, and they combine other components that will also control the hazard. Now, there may be a fire alarm system that warns the occupants to leave the building and at the same time activates a sprinkler system or an inert gas system or other suppression system. So warning systems, depending on how they're designed, can kind of venture into that administrative control area. But most of the time, warning systems can be ignored. And if they can be ignored, they depend on workers making decisions and doing the right thing, they're administrative controls. Then the last level of control that I want to talk about, and I'm going to say the least about it, personal protective equipment. We only use personal protective equipment when other controls aren't possible. When we talk about personal protective equipment, we're talking about clothing, devices, and or devices worn by workers to protect from hazards. Biohazard suits, fire-resistant clothing, arc flash-rated clothing, a respirator, high visibility clothing, safety footwear, harnesses and lanyards, safety glasses, hard hats, so on and so forth. There's a big industry devoted to providing personal protective equipment to the workplace. And personal protective equipment is important. But one thing to pay attention to, for some companies, and again, there are fewer companies like this now, but they are still out there. And I think you see them in maybe construction, oil and gas, agriculture. For them, they only look at personal protective equipment when controlling hazards. They put everybody in a hard hat and safety glasses and high visibility vest, and that's the extent of their safety program. Some safety managers in those companies are basically PPE delivery people. All they do is pass out safety glasses, hard hats, and high visibility vests. That's not likely going to be an effective safety program if that's the extent of controls that are utilized in that operation. As a safety manager, may end up, hopefully not, probably won't, but if you end up in a company like this, our challenge would be to move them into the 21st century of safety management and work with management and persuade them to think about higher levels of control. We've talked about hierarchy of controls. We've talked about mostly about engineering, which can be done through elimination, substitution, or some kind of design or technology. We've talked about administrative controls. And we've talked about personal protective equipment. I would like for you to exercise your critical thinking muscle. This is a 30-point assignment, and the details are in Blackboard. There's a link in Blackboard, Unit 1, Critical Thinking, Hierarchy of Controls, Heat-Related Illness. And what you're going to do in this assignment is deal with this scenario. Workers are shoveling wheat out of a grain truck during the Oklahoma wheat harvest. Late June, heat index 94 degrees Fahrenheit, and they're working out in the sun. They're receiving a full load of sunshine, or full solar loading. What are some controls that could be implemented to alleviate the risk of heat-related illness? In the assignment, and again, the specific instructions are in Blackboard. Go by those specific instructions. Don't just go by this. What are engineering controls that could be implemented to control this hazard and protect the workers? What would be an administrative control? Or what would be a couple of administrative controls? I think in the instructions I asked for two engineering controls, two administrative controls, and two PPE controls. Yeah, this is the kind of problem that we face as safety managers. It's not something we necessarily look up in a book. We have to be able to think about what are some different controls that we might be able to implement, the controls that won't interfere with production, won't interfere with the operation, but will improve the level of safety for the workers. You will need to do some external research, and that's okay. I mean, if let's say you work for co-op. You know, co-op, I believe they do have safety managers. If you work for co-op and you face this particular scenario, you need to come up with some controls. Well, you're gonna talk to other people, which is fine. You can talk to other people about this if you want to. You can call some other safety people and get them involved. That's commonly what we do. You can go to the internet. Internet's a great resource. Look at some of the different ideas that are out there on the internet there are ways to completely eliminate this hazard. And I won't say any more. Do some research. Find those ways to completely eliminate this hazard. Engineering by elimination. There are some administrative controls that are out there that we can find on the internet, in our textbooks, a lot of different resources. So you will need to do some external research. And again, the full instructions are on Blackboard, but you'll need to come up with a two-page report, a report like a report that you might submit to your supervisor. Also a report that contains information that you might use in a training session with workers. So I want it to be fairly well thought out, fairly well presented, a certain degree of professionalism in how it's presented. You'll use Word, you'll submit a Word document, or you can submit it as a PDF if you want to convert your Word document or other word processing file to a PDF, Word or PDF. But again, look at the instructions in Blackboard for the details. And one thing I'll add here, I've seen students in the past, they'll have a spray system where they spray water down on the workers while they're doing this. You can't get the grain wet. You can't get the grain wet. And a little bit of wet grain can spoil or destroy a whole bunch of wheat or other grain as well. So let me know if you have any questions about this. And this brings us to the end of our hierarchy of controls. Again, I'm sorry it was 55 minutes and counting, but you can break it down into two parts if you need to. You don't have to watch it all at one time. Hopefully, at the conclusion of this unit, you have a better idea of what is meant by the term safety engineering. You have a better understanding of this idea of engineering control, but also administrative controls and personal protective controls as well. Now, in the next two units, we're going to continue to expand on the idea of safety engineering. In Unit 2, we're going to talk about systems safety and safety engineering. There are a lot of really cool examples that we're going to look at in Unit 2. Then in Unit 3, which also goes along with Chapter 1 of the text, we're going to talk about prevention through design, some of which we've already touched upon, but it will be expanded upon in Unit 3. All right, have a good day. Let me know if you have any questions.